There is a report of action out of tonight's closed session regarding the anticipated litigation agenda item. The board voted 5-0 in favor of designating Director Hoffman and Director Smallman to work with district council to create an agreed statement regarding Director Smallman's unauthorized disclosures of the district's confidential information, with a goal of releasing that statement signed by Director Smallman to the public by the next president. And that's the end of that statement. So, next item, are there any additions or deletions to the open session agenda?
One, if you request, just asking for Director Hammer, open session, report for closed session, and that would be for, first reading.
Okay, here we go. Motion on the second, any discussion? Call for a voice vote, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, passes four to zero over the phone, Director Anderson. This is the portion of the meeting for oral communications on items which are not on tonight's agenda. So we would like, probably like to speak on something that is not on tonight's agenda. I see one person. I'm adapting and remembering that we have a podium here.
Let me get it where you're at.
Okay.
Good evening, my name is Kevin Collins. I'm here to address the continuation of the fish farm here. The county apparently is working on it and responded to the inquiries that came from the district to them. But in any case, I attended the so-called Creek Water District Board about 3 weeks ago. Their board meeting, and they voted unanimously to continue sampling our watershed, which is what I'm hoping this agency will decide to do. As far as my personal experience in this issue, I was on the Fish and Game Advisory, County's Fish and Game Advisory Commission for 9 years. I installed what is probably the only private designed and engineered fish patch and plow that ever completed in Santa Cruz County. And with a grant from this agency, I managed after a period of years installing them to persuade the regional board, the regional water quality control board, to have a center on the list that is impaired for temperature. I'm still in some stages of administrative stages, but I think it will be finalized soon, and that's a grant that goes way back to 2011. It took forever for it to be processed. But so anyway, as far as the local situation, you know, we could be in this. We appear to be in a ripping drought. So the continuity of scientific information isn't the whole point of doing consecutive fish monitoring and watershed. It's particularly important at the moment. We had the first rain year in 6 years last year. Now it's coming down already. So, and it's important to understand that there's a life cycle process here. A animal that was born in a creek here by an egg laid this winter won't return to this watershed for 4 years, perhaps, sometimes longer. They spend 1, 2, 3 years in the stream. When they go to the ocean, they spend 1 to 3 years in the ocean and they return. So you can't really tell what the long-term impacts are without long-term record keeping. And this watershed has one of the longest records in the state for steelhead and all the coho versions like that out there. It's just one of my support. So anyway, I'm hoping the board will decide to, on its own, in cooperation with SoCal and so forth, we continue to fund the fish monitoring for this watershed in the coming year, 2018.
Anybody else like to speak on an island not on the 19th? Notice the podium. I don't know whether it would be everywhere, but it is here.
by Lois Henry Longpeople. April 10th will be another time we're paying property taxes. And at that point, the people in Longpeople will be paying 20% of the assessment, which means they will be paying 20% on a loan that has not been applied for. And I know, Director Bachman, you didn't think that we were paying for that interest on the loan, but we're paying on the whole package, and that was part of it. And it needs to be, something needs to be done here. Now, I don't know why your general manager doesn't want to say he put that interest on the assessment. He just doesn't seem to want to say he did that. And I've been wrapping my head around that, wondering why. And I thought, well, when the bond failed by one vote, LAFCO told SLB that if they wanted to continue, they had to decide to either accept the terms by, I think it was August of 15, or they had to just start over again. So the board, this board, except for Director Smallman, said they wanted to go ahead. So I'm wondering if it means that that interest could not have been added on later. I don't know, I'm not an attorney. I don't know if LAFCO even is even aware that the interest was added. It's a curiosity to me why that happened. Also, another curiosity to me is why we paid $3,700 for Brent Isles to come talk about the board policy when you weren't even ready for it. I like Brent. He's a great guy. Knows a lot of stuff. Former mayor of Tracy. But why spend $3,700 for him to come talk about board policy when it wasn't even halfway finished and has gone back to the committee? I don't know. Thank you.
Thank you. Would somebody else like to speak?
So really quickly, I was hoping to suggest to the board that hasn't already become idle, maybe for the next board meeting, to start getting into preparation time. I was actually hoping it would be in this meeting as part of the proactive approach to that. It's very possible we can still get some significant rain, but with 12 to 16 inches, it's not looking in February. It's not looking good. I agree, but it's not looking good. I think at that point, we need to be talking about potential cuts might be necessary, what impact that would have on the rates, if any. And that kind of thing, to start doing the public thinking about that. I think it'd be a very good proactive thing to be working to do. But the second thing is a question. I forget this process, but there's two items in the consent agenda that I'd like to learn a little bit more about. That's 11B and E. But it says that only a board member can request an item to be withdrawn. How would we go about getting more information about those two items as part of the discussion that would actually be on tape for potential people to view if we can't pull it out?
So the board policy manual provides for public members to be able to pull items from the consent agenda. The agenda as written says that the board can pull items from the agenda. I think that a request from a public member, I'm pretty confident that we can have at least one board member agree to pull those items from the consent agenda. reminder.
Reminder, okay. Would anybody else like to speak on?
It's Deborah Lowen, Montego, and just pulling up on Lois, I'm going to write a letter about this later in next agenda, but I'd like to mention that now, Director Ballman, I would like to request that either on the April or May meeting, a specific agenda item be put on about the Montego project and moving forward with this loan and having all the information ready. I'd also like to request that meeting take place at the Zionist Fire District. They have a community meeting too. This is wonderful. This is a real neighborhood thing. And I think it would be helpful to have it closer to Montego so that hopefully people could attend. Last April, we had it in Felton when there was also going to be a hearing on Montego search margin. We had a very good turnout. Unfortunately, we never got to that agenda item that had to be continued. So that's kind of a request. An agenda item forwarding the Montego project, loan, and meeting as I am. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anybody else like to speak? Please come to our new podium. Would the person in the back, Sarah, first?
Oh, sorry.
I think there's only one more after that.
I have a bad foot, so it's hard for me to get over there.
We'll give you time.
Good evening, I'm Nancy Macy. I'm here representing the Environmental Committee for San Rosa Valley, which is a project of the Valley of the Sun. I have some great news, except for Kevin already blew my announcement. The SoCal Water Board voted unanimously to have DW Alley and Associates do fish sampling in SoCal Creek this year for Dow County Administration. County staff though was there and was willing to accept the data for the database as usual. This just happened at their last meeting. As our elected representatives, we encourage and expect you to do the same. We hope that since the monitoring program has been in place for many years, and the products are clearly defined long since, the work involved will be doable, as SoCal is demonstrating. The SoCal Creek Water Board is both maintaining monitoring while supporting the exciting plans of the Joint Juvenile Steelhead Downstream Habitat Monitoring Program. The public may not realize the significance of having our district, the county, the city of Santa Cruz, SoCal Creek Water District, and the cities of Capitola and Watsonville all working together on this project. It is rather extraordinary. SLB Water District has a major role because of its decades of leadership and the ability of its highly skilled staff to work closely with the county and the others on this issue. This district has always led the way. It is such a remarkable thing, having over 20 years of fish monitoring data and summary reports to draw on to help guide your policies and decision making, seeing how patterns emerge that can guide planning. We can all be proud of the district's role in supporting this, first on its own and then in partnership. The district knows that the salmonid populations directly reflect the health of the watershed and therefore the health of the source of our water supply. Perhaps with so much time and energy focused on this issue, it's hard not to feel that as much as possible is already happening or has been done or is being done to support fish. It is hard, and also that the suggestions for improvement in the reports based on years of data are already being addressed. But we can't say that yet. Not yet. This is demonstrated in a summary of some of the more important, not yet confronted problems that need to be addressed in the near future. Attached to on the back here, I'm not going to read those today. But it's a later issue, and you can look at them later. Since our region is entering a perilous future with climate change already impacting our rain levels, increasing fluctuations, and adding to the many stresses on our precious aquifer, increased effort must be made. In conclusion, tonight we strongly request that the SLB Water Board continue to lead by maintaining its policy of salmonid monitoring and reporting again this year, as done for decades previously. And I hope you will read the rest of the letter because it does have some really cool things about future stuff to work together. Thank you.
Thank you.
people who have a hard time making it to the podium if you have a right kind of account. But what I wanted to bring up is that it appears to me you're almost on track, but it sounds like you might have avoided a lawsuit, hopefully you do, but had you brought this one on, you would have been on track to charging everybody who's a ratepayer $10 a month for legal fees. So I'm just hoping that maybe you guys will get over this addiction to lawsuits. It's not really a healthy environment for the ratepayer. Goes up every year, it seems like the rates go up. You know, so you add $10 on every month to everybody's fees. You know, that's not fair. And I mean, I currently got injured due to a hazard that was set up by San Lorenzo Valley Water District. And I'm hoping that this doesn't end up being like some five-year affair. I have nothing against ratepayers. I have nothing against San Lorenzo Valley Water District. I just am surprised, like, when they had the five-year to try to take my property for nothing. Of course I have to do something. I've got to stand up for myself. You know, and you guys dragged that out for 5 years, and I've got a technical win. You know, it wasn't very gratifying, but you know, this one here, all I can say is that I hope, like, there's this big hole right over here. You just talk about safety and stuff. A big old hole right over here by the what's that? It's not Junction Park, so that's that San Lorenzo Park over here where the bridge is over Irwin. I mean, it's like glaciers, and it goes underneath the road, and there's like this cone, like right over by the corner of the bridge. And you look and go, holy thing, you know, a truck driving over that's going to fall into the hole. You know, just even going and get, you must know what I'm talking about, right? Oh, you should check. Oh, it's a huge, oh my God. Yeah, and then, so you've got a meter over there at the park, right? And then, so that, it appears to me that it's getting undermined by water, so maybe somebody wants to pay attention to it, but I mean, I see, and I have to drive by that all the time, so I drive away because I know that it's hollow underneath, and I don't want to go kaboom in the hole. Anyway, I still got 30 seconds. Well, anyways, I hope that, like I said, get over your addiction for litigation and have, boy, I can't wait, this year voting? I hope we get a lot more of Bill Smallman. I really do. I mean, you're a good man. I'm sorry this is happening to you. All right.
I'm Chris Holler from the Boulder Creek. You had a meeting last month, and Don Allen was here. I support the continuing fish monitoring that he's been doing for years. So I'm glad that it's been worked out, that other agencies are willing to cooperate and willing to put part of the bill. And so Don's going to be able to finish that. So I think that's great. I want to remind the board that the board has been in violation of this water permit on Fall Creek ever since this district took over the Fall Creek water system. The director of operations informed the board that the district was in violation of its permit every day of October. If it doesn't rain, the district will be in violation of its permit every day of May. The solution to the problem is to turn on the intertide and supply groundwater to Felton when the flow in the river is too low. In other words, comply with the permit. It seems like a modest proposal to me, merely to comply with the permit. The permit was a result of a process that took about 10 years between the 70s and the 80s, and it involved the city of Santa Cruz and the county of Santa Cruz. And so it was a compromise. The restrictions that are there about river flow and creek flow are compromised. And the district simply ignores these requirements. And you're the only water agency I know of just flat out ignores your permit requirements. I guess I want to talk a little bit about the territory here that you imagine the paper. And I don't really have enough time. But first thing is, people have asked me, wow, you know, what was in that letter? What was the big deal? The thing was that he had to make a request, a written request. And unfortunately, that request got forwarded to the board via the attorney. And so it became this issue about attorney-client privilege. But Section 995 says that upon request. If you read Section 995, the first word is accept. Accept. You can't parse that sentence unless you understand what accept means. And it says accept 995.2. When you start reading 995.2, there's three reasons there why the district could deny representations of someone with ulterior bureau. And all three apply. Actually, if I had one time, I said all three apply. You shouldn't have spent $1 on this area here. And I'll be back later.
Would anybody else like to speak on an item that is not on the agenda? I see none. So, do another one of communications.
Sure.
We will move on to the first item of new business, which is the public committee member appointments. So, staff, want to say anything first item to anybody?
Staff does have approval to provide. So, as far as staff is aware, all of the current public members of the committees have indicated a willingness to continue with serving on the committees, except for Rick Moran, the environmental committee. We did receive his resignation, so he has chosen not to continue serving as a public member. So, I would request that the board tonight at least recognize that absent a decision tonight on one of the applicants serving on the environmental committee, we will be missing the public member for that committee. Additionally, we did send out requests to all of the applicants requesting that they be here tonight for possible Q&A with the board. So hopefully they have all decided to attend tonight. I'm not aware of all of anyone indicating they would not be able to make it. Have they?
Yeah.
No. So with that in mind, I will turn it back over to the board.
Okay. So we have four standing committees outside of that of the Long Peak Assessment District Oversight Committee. And we are considering the public member appointment on each of those four committees. And we currently have the gentleman John Dodge Hayes is on Budget and Finance. Mr. Fultz, who I see here this evening, is on the Admin Committee. Rick Moran, who was just mentioned, is in our Environmental Committee. Mr. Patrick, okay, is engineering. So, I have three pages of how to think about this thing. At the time, and so I want to describe the process as well as possible, maybe get some buy-in from the rest of the board in case this sounds, you know, this sounds good or does not sound good. And then start through a process of, let me first gauge how many people are here tonight who are wishing to be on these committees. And just raise your hand, you don't need to identify yourself, so I can get an idea. So I see three present members. Okay. I'm considering that each of the directors, well, first take oral communication from the public on this item, and then we'll move to where directors can ask a question of each applicant. And I've done the same question. I'll probably ask everybody the same question. With agreement from the rest of the directors, we'll discuss each committee in order. In some order that seems to make sense to the chair, and if I have some disagreement. So some of them may be simple appointments where there's only one person interested or in. And for others, there may be some more debate or some more thought needs to be put into that process. And then I'll come back and select one committee and then take nominations from the directors as to the board policy manual for appointments to that. And then we'll have some discussion about that and then make it on that. So I'd like to point out that coming here tonight, we had 6 applicants for 4 committees, and there's been one that has come since the board packet. And that's included with the application forms that the directors have received, and I assume they're public, okay? And we should, I think that person has expressed an interest in budget and finance. So, so at this point, I'll ask the public, would anybody like to comment on this process or anything regarding the appointments to these committees?
Can I ask a question?
Sure, yeah. Well, I'm not sure you can give an answer, but comment at least. And so that we
will. Well, what can I comment on? Can I comment on somebody who's on a committee?
You can comment on anything regarding, if you want to suggest that one of our applicants be considered. Okay. Strongly or?
Well, I almost hate to say I support somebody because you probably won't like him then, but said John Hayes, he's out of town for work. John Hayes really likes all of you folks, even though he seems to like me too, even though we're at odds. I don't get it, maybe the man's all confused, but no. John Hayes is the kind of guy who wants to bring people together. He wants to work problems out. I think he's a perfect person to be on the committee, the finance committee that he's on. I think he knows what he's doing, he's smart, he likes Brian Lee. That ought to be a plus for him. Anyway, I like him. I think he's good. That's all.
Thank you.
Hello, policy. We joined SLB in 2016. And I have to say, I've met some really remarkable people that live here in the district. And 2 of the people that are my favorites who have really contributed that I think all ratepayers should be really grateful for are John Hayes, as well as he said. Bob Bolts. One of the first committee meetings we went to was admin committee, and I was so impressed with him. I'll leave that there. Join daggers at me. I think these are real keepers, and I really encourage the board to keep hold of them on this committee. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other persons want to comment on the selection of these committees? I don't see anybody, so I'll close out all communication on this item. So part of, I believe there are perhaps the best way to go through this is allow, I see 3, okay, with 3 people here, okay, and present this evening, and go through our questions of the people considering that maybe not everybody gets to be on the committee they want to be on. And actually, first, could I ask the people, the 3 individuals who raised their hands to identify who they are? Mr. Bolts, okay, Bob Bolts, and the gentleman back here?
Fred Stevens from Wampiga.
Okay, thank you for coming. And yourself?
Katie Gomez.
Okay, thank you.
I did tell everyone that if they came to the meeting and they had filled out an application, that they would have the opportunity to speak.
Okay. I think that's a good thing. Let's do that first. Would any of the 3 of you like to speak? This is not compulsory, but we have the opportunity to if you want to. We'll proceed with maybe asking some questions.
I'm Jenny Gomez. I'm applying to the environmental committee. I believe in good environmental stewardship. I'm a
achieving sustainability, both for ourselves and our fellow creatures of and species of the San Lorenzo Valley. As I mentioned in my application, I'm a GIS analyst. I've been working in that field for over 15 years. For a time, I worked for an environmental consulting firm where I worked with biologists and ornithologists and herpetologists and lots of biological surveys and analysis, primarily for CEQA-related impact analysis and restoration work as well. As a neighborhood organizer, I also wrote and was awarded a community development block grant for my neighborhood. I planted over 200 trees and did sidewalk cuts and for the tree wells. As a volunteer, I worked on a lot of habitat restoration projects and invasive species around there. I really hope to be a part of the community.
Thank you. Thank you.
I am Bob Foltz. I do serve on the admin committee currently. Just a little background for those who may not know me. I've spent more years than I'd like to think about working at Silicon Valley and in a variety of roles, primarily in marketing, product design and development, and most recently as CFO of a startup company. So I have a very good range of a lot of the processes and procedures that go into actually getting things done. I try to approach my membership in the committee as representing people who aren't necessarily as in tune with the intricacies in and outs of how the water district operates, and bring that kind of perspective to the committee, an independent perspective, one that is trying to think outside the box of, well, how can we do things differently, better, and hopefully more productive and efficient. There's a lot of work still to be done on the admin committee. I'm sure there's a lot of work to be done on all committees, but there's a lot of work that I feel we haven't finished yet, mainly around policies and procedures and some of the outreach activities that we'd like to do with the community, which I think are, as we've seen from some of the controversies over the last couple of years, I think they're very, very down to you in a variety of ways. And I'd like to continue that work. So thank you for your consideration. I'm certainly happy to answer any questions now or later. If you have.
I'll ask the director if they have questions.
Okay, well, not much of a support, but my name is Fred Stevens, and I'm recently retired. As my application states, I spent the last 22 and a half years working at the City of Santa Cruz Wastewater Treatment Plant. I was the lead mechanic down there, which dealt with a lot of engineering, pumps, pipes, everything down there. I worked closely with my boss on budgeting and finance and the administration of the maintenance shop, the maintenance department. I just wanted to, be involved in the, the running of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District. As a ratepayer, I'm concerned about how it's run, and I'd like to have, some kind of input into it, even if it's, behind the scenes. I'm not much of a political, activist of any sort, but I'd rather work behind the scenes, not up here doing this. And that's pretty much all I have. Okay.
Okay. My suggestion is that reconsider the, well, let's go to questions. Okay, the directors, within the directors at this point, like, to ask a question. We can come back later. I was asking, when I scheduled this or put this in my tentative process of this, I was thinking that we might have more people present, okay, and it might be some deep thought needed to resolve some of the choices in front of us. So, anybody care to speak to anybody right now, or can we pick a committee and discuss it?
I'm happy to start with specific committees. Let's go.
Okay. Then I'll suggest that we start with budget and finance. It seems there's public comment about that. And would anybody like to leave any thoughts on that?
We have heard glowing remarks about Mr. Hayes. I think that all of our experience, though some of us have more limited experience with him than others, have the same glowing opinion of him. So I don't, since he's not here with us this evening, there's not a question we can ask. So I would just maybe ask the committee members, or board members who share time with him as a committee member, to reflect on how he is as a committee member and his potential continuance.
I second that. I'm not sure if we're making.
That was really a more of a discussion.
We're not quite at nominating. But we'll be there soon. You can make the quote. But you want to speak about it?
Yeah, I'm sorry for John
here. Okay.
But I don't know. I agree with everybody's assessment. He just seems, really on top of he has the talent and a lot of people here that are volunteering also as well, but Mr. Hayes got my vote. So.
Well, having served on the committee with him, I have to say he's got great technical grasp and he's got some history with the district as far as having a good overall view of sort of the trends within the district. I also think it's a positive thing, as he mentions in his application, that his employer is very flexible about so attendance and meetings wouldn't be an obstacle the way it is for, the Arab Hamid. So I thought that was good. So there's a hardship for him. And, I think we've all been favorably impressed by his attendance for the committee meetings, which is not always possible for him, but it shows real investment in the committee and the Post Knowledge that also attends quite a few white meetings.
Consider another committee. environmental, I think, would be good. Mr. Moran chosen not to continue on that. I want to say I very much appreciate the time you spent on that. Anybody who comes and gives thoughtful input, is to be commended for doing so.
And I will point out, he also attended many board of directors meetings in addition to his committee meetings, which again is not required as a committee member, but it's much appreciated by the board of directors.
He did.
I'll just say that we had two excellent applicants, and I was frustrated about how we would decide. What I liked about both our applicants is they had practical experience, either directly work-related or work in community service-related in this field. And I think having practical experience in the environmental field is a real asset because you realize the complexity of the issues that we wrestle with. And I think that's always helpful. So, and specific to our challenges here, things like water supply, forestry issues, watershed issues, and invasive plants. So we're sort of spoiled for choice. But I do believe that Ms. Gomez is here, and I think her attendance here is a plus. But it would have been a hard choice. And therefore, I think if she was able to attend this evening,
I similarly lean very hard in that direction. I'm aware of the level of effort that was before the district for its watershed stewardship obligations, invasive species, landscape management, watershed management. And so I think Ms. Gomez's experience lends itself well to that. With regard to invasive species management, we have an IPM policy and program that is in development, and I think her experience will help us continue to steward that forward in a thoughtful and careful way. So I would put my support behind the nomination of Ms. Gomez.
I agree. I know Jenny says she's a fellow Montecan. I think we had a little bit of disagreement on the Scotch Road stuff, but I can't even see her. She's still there. Okay. but I really agree with, and I really appreciate you calling up with us a month ago. All that involvement that you had in the past, I think you're the person that was really the helpful, and I think you really would enjoy involvement with that, because it's so very important. Because this is not a city water district. We live in it. It's a very special environment. Environmental issues are so involved, so I really appreciate that you have that expertise. And then so you get my vote. It's a good.
And I feel likewise. I was afraid we were going to have a difficult decision tonight, and it's good to have difficult choices in front of you. But I've actually Ms. Gomez in the field. I was not anticipating it, but we bumped into each other and hit restoration of them. So I like folks who can think through the process, can be a contributor to good policy, who bring special skills. I think GIS tools are a very valuable thing for being able to visualize things at times and can be useful. I don't know that her skills will need to be exercise. We do have a GIS test person, but I feel very good about her being the appointee to this. And that's it for me.
I would move selection of
doing this since I went to the trouble of putting an application in?
Yes.
Especially for that place, before you look?
Sure. That person?
It was in the packet.
Well, the applications are in the packet.
I'm sure it was.
And that is Steve Davidson, and he had a background, very interested in watersheds and streams and fish.
I'll be right back.
Okay. I'll need to put on all the... Go get the pack. There were other... For budget and finance, John Hayes was on there, and I believe he was the only...
We had a late applicant, Sylvia J. Eugene.
Yes, there's another person, Eugene, so he tried, okay, who submitted an application that is not here this evening.
And was he in the board pack?
Yes, he's in the late edition to it, so there's a public copy, he was not, his application was not received in time, he had the board pack. So I'm gonna wait until George Paul can come back and take a vote on it.
Note to staff, working firehouse, maybe not the best place to have a public hearing.
So, the number is, I'll call the vote, Virginia Gomez, all those in favor, say aye.
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 Aye, any opposed? Very done, Ms. Gomez, fairly environmental.
Thank you. Thank you, congratulations.
Do we have on our next committee, we have a right now, we have time to borrow that, would you need? That's what this is.
Calendar and number. Do I know when it is? Oh, I'm sorry, yes, the next environmental committee is on Wednesday at 10 o'clock.
That was me.
Next week.
Oh, next week. Very good. So, the next committee, I think, might be appropriate to consider, is the engineering committee. We have one person, Mr. Stevens, who is here this evening, and Brian, you said that Dan also expressed that.
Dan actually did not. Dan has been silent, which is really odd. I'm suspicious that he might not be somewhere available for communication, because he is typically more responsive than that, but he has not responded in affirmative to serve on the committee.
So we have there were two people who were strongly interested in serving on the engineering committee, and that was Mr. Stevens, who is here this evening, and actually the other people were willing to
second choice
as a second choice, but Mr. Stevens is the primary, I believe, only perhaps. No, he was willing also to consider other committee appointments.
I know, it wasn't well written, but yeah.
We understood it fine.
Yeah. Anybody like that? Mr. Stevens, any questions?
No.
I'm not going to.
I'll just repeat my comment that I appreciate practical experience, and I appreciate availability. So those are both practical considerations that people serve as well. And I appreciate you showing up. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll say some experience in wastewater is not a bad thing. Okay, someone to...
I've seen my share of bugs down the way.
Okay.
I spent a lot of time in the lab.
Okay. It's a timely skill for us at this point. I'm comfortable.
I would...
Well, I don't know if you were there in 94, but I was working with Humphrey Construction Rebuilding.
That's exactly what, when I started. I started in January of 95 when the construction was going on.
And I know you bumped some heads because in Lompico, because, you know, because we're close and I have bumped.
Yeah.
But I know
much of the political stuff.
And I think you have some really, really good qualities. I know you do, because...
Well, I spent my time...
You know, it's a hard job working on those treatment plants.
I spent my time in the trenches. And,
yeah.
And I know, I've spent a lot of
time
dealing with that stuff.
That's my type of guy.
I would
like to have on the engineering committee. I'll second that.
Okay. Any further discussion? Well, I'll call this on the voice vote as we have the others. All those in favor, please take them.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Welcome.
Welcome.
As you said, though, that the engineering committee is already full.
No, you are our choice tonight to be that person.
Okay.
I hope we get a chance to thank Dan for his time on that, and please, if you can communicate with him.
I will reach out to him, continue to reach out to him until I appreciate him on that.
This is once a month, or like once a month, but then we, you know, can give all the information on all the projects that we're,
That would be helpful, I'm just going into this really cold and...
Well, Brian, we'll warn you up, we'll figure out.
Just remember, I'm retired.
We'll make sure you're busy now.
Oh, okay. No, the girlfriend does know that. I have enough projects to...
Okay, so admin, we have one more committee to consider, and that's admin committee. And there were two people who expressed a preference for that. Mr. Bulls, who's here tonight, and Mr. Darren Dinger. I don't know how to pronounce his last name, and he's not here, so he can't correct me.
But may I speak up since I chair committee with Mr. Bulls and have for a while? And I want to express my appreciation for his dedication. He is devoted, comes prepared, has thoughtful input. We don't always agree, but the balance of his input means that we all come to a better, more informed consensus. So I want to appreciate him for showing up today and continuing his dedicated service. I thought the other applicant, Mark, I apologize for not pronouncing the right name correctly, Darren Dinger, has apparently some great qualifications and some interesting experience that could potentially have served us well, but I think it goes without saying that the world is run by those who show up. Thank you. I am pleased to continue Mr. Bulls' service.
I'll agree with that. I've known Bob for a number of years now, and found him to be an intelligent person who brings good perspective and been a hard worker on the committee. I'm glad to continue. Okay.
It's great to have more than one candidate, and I think they made our job easier by those who showed up. Bonus points, but we had a lot of excellent candidates, and I'm hoping that we can recruit some of those for grant committees or other things.
Justin Bunch was turned up as, Bob Fulton, he's got my vote, he's really been coming to meetings and been active, he's got my vote.
All those in favor of appointing Mr. Bulls to the admin committee, please say so.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? None.
appreciate it. Appreciate your comments.
Good. Okay. Great. So let's move on to the next new business item. The Consolidated Redevelopment Oversight Program 2018 ballot. And I'll let staff describe.
LAFCO has an opening. There are two applicants for the position. One is from Sanford Port District and the other from Scotts Valley Water District. Staff has no recommendation other than we like water district.
Yeah, I'd like to recommend for any member. Mr. David Clyde, to be quite frank and honest, I think have our partnership with the Scotts Valley Water District is important. He's got my vote.
And I would just like to say, I would endorse the recommendation to take the secondary candidate as an alternate candidate for us, so.
We can vote on this.
Yeah.
I would also support Mr. David Hodgson. He's, in my experience encountering him at a number of different office events, he thinks about water, his water district first, obviously, then he thinks about water districts, then he thinks about water, and he thinks about local government. So I think he has a really commendable frame of reference that serves us well in this role.
And he's got excellent experience with all kinds of governmental bodies, so he'll be very effective.
I agree with the directors. I don't know him well. I do see that he's got a very extensive background. He's always seemed like a good person that you could work with. And it's good to develop relationships with those with whom we already have a relationship. So, since Scotts Valley and ourselves are the major participants, the largest participants in the new groundwater sustainability agency that's been formed. He's not an appointee to it, but could be. So I'm very comfortable. Any other discussion?
You're involved.
Oh, awesome. Public comment. I think we actually put public comment on all of these, but that might not be correct. But if anybody would like to comment, just Twitter on this appointment, please.
I just have a question. Are all water, so this is an appointment for LAFCO. Is that correct?
No, I don't think that's exactly. I thought it was the region. No. So,
it's the accessory agency to the redevelopment.
So do all water districts weigh in on these nominations?
Okay. All special districts of which
right. Water all water districts. Okay.
Any other comments? I don't see any. We have a call to vote. All those in favor of and there'll be two votes. This is the appointee to it, and then there's a choice about whether the other person can be on. So, on the first, which is the question of who to appoint, who do we vote for as a board for the appointment, and that is Mr. David Hodgson. So, all those in favor of that, please.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, our vote is for David.
I would move that we support Reed Gastrider as the alternate to the position.
That's the second part. I move to alternate position. If there were no nominations, it says that no nominations filed for the alternate position on the oversight board, there are two options, offer an alternate or offer the alternate position to the runner-up. Or don't fill the alternate position. And following your recommendation, it would be to offer whoever the runner-up is the alternate position. Yeah. And your motion is to offer the runner-up the alternate position.
Yes,
and I second that motion.
I believe the space that he is the current holder of that position. So he's eminently qualified to be the alternate for it. So I cannot imagine not voting for him in that manner.
I prefer that you not vote for an alternate. Reed Gutschreiter lives at the end of 13th Avenue, and he built a huge garage that blocks the ocean view of everyone on that street. He manipulated the political process in order to do that. It went all the way to the Coastal Commission. Somehow he got away with it. But I think he's the Terry Vieira of Live Oak.
Okay, thank you for your input. Anybody else? Okay, anybody? Any further discussion on this? And we have a motion? So I'll call the vote. All those in favor of appointing Mr. Gutschreiter?
Well, the runner-up.
For the runner-up. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none. So let's move to the next item of new business.
So Mother Nature has taken a very concerning issue and elevated it to a very, very troubling issue regarding Well 6 and Paso Tiempo. We have been limping along with this well for a number of years, doing all we can to keep alive, and last year staff made the decision to move forward with replacement. It was deemed just not worth saving. It had reached the end of its useful life. We have been working with the environmental permitting agencies to get the ability to actually go in there and work on this well. We were granted that just last week or the week prior, and we have the ability to go in there now. With the drought conditions that have been mentioned earlier, it is imperative that we get this well in as fast as possible. We are requesting that the board waive the committed bidding requirements for Mark Feeney. Mr. Feeney has, and Rick can verify this, but he's been involved, if not in all of our wells, at least a good chunk of our wells that we've constructed in the past few decades. He worked on the Scotts Valley well that they just recently have turned into service, I believe. I think they've got the green light to turn that into service. And so he knows our groundwater basin. He knows most of the groundwater basin in Santa Cruz and Monterey County. Highly recommended both by staff and by the industry as a whole. So we are requesting a formal waiver of bidding procedures so that we can move forward on bidding this well and have the expertise on hand while it is being constructed so we can do it as fast as possible.
He also works hand in hand with Nick Johnson, a biologist that worked very well together, and have a great understanding together of the office for hand well construction. It is voluntary, but it is needed in the construction of the well.
My question is, on this quote, is does this include the actual well drilling itself, or is it
just it's for design of the well and the construction, monitoring of the well and development of the well?
Okay.
Engineering project management services.
So then, but then, in addition to actually constructing this well, what do you estimate cost?
If the board approves tonight, we move straight forward with the bidding process for the well, and we hope that 30-day bidding process.
Okay. But that's in addition to the, what is it, 63?
Right. Those are well constructions in addition. But, you know,
$500,000 to $1 million project.
Okay.
We will be coming back to the board with the bids, contractor bids, to construct the road for the board.
Do you think that, I mean, that for the work that he's doing is a reasonable?
I do.
Oh, yeah.
I do.
And I did once, but I'm not, okay. Seems like a decent call.
Yeah, I just want to make sure that this is money well done.
It's familiarity with the aquifer, it helps a lot.
It helps. And he works closely, work closely with Mike Cloud, the county union, or high officers. He's got a very good understanding of the aquifer, so he's in the right field.
I would just reiterate, I think that, you know, comments prior made, notwithstanding that this district is very, very cognizant of the fact that we have had very little rain. And we're soon going to go off our surface water supplies, and so we're going to have to rely on our groundwater sources. And they have to be reliable wells. So even though I'm a fan of not foregoing competitive bid processes, I have a sense of urgency about this, and I am strongly in favor of this.
Thank you. One other, I think maybe we mentioned in the materials we have, is that because it's so closely, the replacement well would be so close to the existing well that any sort of CEQA process is unlikely to.
It is a replacement well. It would be constructed very similar to the well replacement. So it's definitely a replacement well, and we will be part of the process to contract the replacement. We will be destroying the existing well. It'll be part, actually. We'll destroy the existing well first, and then do the replacement.
But it's not moving into pristine sand hills there or something like
that. We've had that already taken care of the Federal Fish and Wildlife, and they've been moving through that process. We've also took it through the state of California, Department of Water Resources, and got an approval for the location. That work has been done.
Thank you.
Just out of curiosity, is that kind of thing a categorical exemption or? Yeah, okay.
Any public input on the topic?
I just have a question.
Okay, go ahead and then.
Hi, Barbara Norwell. The question that I have is for Rick. Rick, why would you destroy the original well first and then build the second one? What if you have a problem with the second one? I mean, wouldn't you keep your original well and then and have them in parallel?
I can answer.
Yes, if you go back.
The existing well, the casing has collapsed. It is not functional. The grout pack has come in. We want to destroy that well first because we don't want to damage the new well. It's an explosion. It's an underground explosion with concrete that blows into the aquifer and splits the screens for a good seal to keep contamination.
Okay.
So when you do that, we don't want to take the chance because the other well is so close.
Sure.
We don't want to damage.
Okay.
But this well here has reached its life expectancy. We can't use it. Grout pack is caved in.
Yeah, I didn't realize that
you were
doing actual
demolition. Okay. And we have another well in that general area. Is it number six?
We have passage chamber 7, which is about 1,400 feet from that, and we have passage chamber 5A, which is approximately 700 feet. All on the same question.
And they're the active wells now?
That's correct. 7 is getting ready to be rehabbed. It's all fine right now to be rehabbed, and 5A is now.
Well, you kind of answered my question there. I was wondering how many other wells you have right in the area, and how many people are you serving? And it sounds like this, it could be an emergency situation.
It serves the south system.
And we have the intertide. So with the intertide, there isn't a big emergency. But as we get more into the summer months, yes. I guess they're going to run out of water because of it. But there is an urgency to get it for redundancy, fire, fall. We need to move forward.
Any other questions? I don't see any. discussion? Do I hear a motion?
I would move approval of resolution number... There we go. Move approval of resolution 17-18.
I'll second.
Of the design and construction.
There are no disagreement on that, I'll call it a voice vote. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
No.
So we have one item left in new business, which is a request for authorization to attend a conference with reimbursement.
Okay.
Well, let me let staff go first. I'm not going to write to you.
I actually would like to, this was from, I didn't actually put this on the agenda. And I can't go. I don't want to even waste the time because I cannot attend this conference. Like 6 weeks ago, I do have a friend who lives in Salt Lake City, so I thought, hey, I could, you know, possibly cover my expenses of going to this thing, but I cannot go, so I think I didn't have the opportunity, so I
subsequently lowering the pay scale for that staff as well, so that we can fill that position. And then we are also adding an additional, we're not adding a staff member, so I want to say this right. We're adding a lead service worker position, but we're going to fill that with existing staff. So it's no change in staffing, it's just we're shifting the pieces around so that we can have two field crews out there.
Thank you. We had one request to pull those two items. I'll ask anybody else who wants to pull one. I don't see that. Did any director want to pull the other one?
Oh, there was a member of the public who was interested in doing so, so I don't mind pulling those from the consent. I would just suggest that we take care of what consent agenda items we can finish, and I would move that we move approval of consent agenda items A, B, and C, and then move on to the others that we pulled for the consent.
Okay. Then I call the vote on items A, B, and C. All those in favor of approving those items, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none. And let me make sure I'm clear. You want to pull B and okay.
For the sake of public discussion, since I remember the public who was interested in more detail, we had a brief explanation of what those are. So we can probably now open this up for the public comment question, and then we can come back.
Okay. So item 11D, the pay advance policy, would anybody in the public want to comment?
This will be fast, so I promise to make this. So in the, it's a policy, and so in the, when I was reading through the policy, it seemed like they're saying this pay policy is different from an emergency policy, but then it went on to say that in order to get the payment under this policy, it had to be an emergency situation. So I wasn't really sure if that was clear. It wasn't clear to me. And since this hadn't been in front of the admin committee where we deal with a lot of policies, and I understand that there's probably some urgency here because somebody needs money, I just want to make sure I understood that. Is this meant to be an emergency thing, or is it meant to not be an emergency thing? That is, anyone can ask for it if they feel they need it.
So there's HR definitions for hardship or emergency. This policy does not cover those conditions. So, but it is strongly encouraged that the employee who requests a pay advance have a good reason for it. We don't want just any employee saying, hey, I'd like to get a pay advance on our situation. So we do say that it's going to require an extraordinary emergency situation, even though it doesn't have the HR definition of that hardship or emergency loan policy.
I think the confusion maybe is including the word emergency in both categories. So maybe what we could do is say we require an extraordinary delete or emergency, and just make it extraordinary. Because that way, you're not letting the water in the policy. It's just a suggestion. So is this kind of like a payday loan without interest and a very short repayment? I mean, that's the other question. Is that kind of the intent here, is that kind of thing?
You want to do it that way, sure.
Yeah,
I mean that's
yeah. It's helping out our employees.
Yes.
Okay, that was my only comment. So thank you.
I took a quick look over somebody's shoulder at the policy. Also, I think I saw a bill this item where the employee got $1,000. This is an employee who's worked here for years and years. I just wanted to tell you a little bit about an experience that I had. Back in 2000, was the height of the dot-com boom, and my employer gave me a bonus if I would work there for another 6 months. and at the time I was getting divorced. So the other side came to court and they said, well, this is how much money he makes, and I was getting an extra $25,000 every 6 months. So let's set the child support and so on, you know, accordingly. And my attorney advocated, well, wait a minute, you know, he may get fired, he may, you know, the agreement that they gave me said that if I didn't work there for the full 6 months, I would have to return the bonus. And so my attorney was advocating that, hey, please don't assume this is his permanent compensation, you know, going forward. This is only for this period of time. And if he gets fired or quits or something, he's going to have to pay the money back. And at that point, the judge said, good luck to any employment attorney that tries to make an employee pay the money back. Good luck. So this $1,000 or whatever it would be, 1 week's pay, whatever it would be, it says in the policy the employee has to pay the money back. But in my mind, I kind of have it on good authority. Superior court judge, you can never do that. You can never make them pay the money back.
Senior field service workers position. Staff gave a brief presentation about this and explained that this is a rewording of staff classifications for existing employees so that we have more flexibility to do more with what we have. Should I phrase it that way?
And to make sure we can recruit individuals that are appropriate for the job description that we need to do.
So, I feel like it perhaps earlier.
The only other specific part was the change in classification of the driving license. Right?
Removing the class A requirement, yeah.
Public comment on that?
Again, I'll be brief. So just to make sure I had in my mind, we're taking this is an open position, and we're dropping its classification down in order to make it so that there's some existing employees that we want to promote into both of these lead positions. Am I following that right?
And try and answer the way we have it. So we currently have a senior field service worker and then a lead field service worker.
And the lead works for the senior.
And the lead works for the senior. So what we're doing is we're dropping the senior down so that we'll have two lead field service workers who will have the ability to have two construction crews out there with somebody on site who is knowledgeable and knows how to operate a shovel.
So the senior wouldn't go in the field?
Typically the senior's not going in the field.
And is that senior already filled or being dropped?
No. We are trying to actually fill one of the... Okay. With this change, we will have one open lead field service worker position that we may recruit in internally too, or we may have to go externally to get that.
Good, because I didn't think you were devoting somebody, but I wanted to make sure.
Yeah.
That's not the case. Okay, thank you.
Question. A few months ago, there was some discussion about having a salary survey. I haven't heard anything about it since, so I'm curious as to what stage that's in. But given that fact, my experience is in industry, you don't do reclassifications during a salary survey because it's like getting a cart before the horse. You know, you could, in fact, create a problem with what you're about to do with your salary survey. And that's the whole point, is to repeg, right? How can you be repegging if you're trying to end with a target? So I'm just wondering, is this possibly going to create some problems with that salary survey information that I think was already progressing, or where is it?
The salary survey, we've been working with the employees union to develop some understandings and frameworks around how the salary survey will be operated and what the end results are going to be, with the intent of having everybody at the table agreeing what the end results are going to be before we even start this. Because I don't want anybody going to the end and saying, nope, I don't want that. So we are still in negotiation with the union on that. It is a time-consuming process, obviously. Otherwise, we'd be a lot farther along than we are. I do not have an anticipated end date to the salary survey, so I don't see that impacting, this change impacting the salary survey. I mean, this one is an immediate need. The salary survey is a long-term need, so.
I understand that, but still the follow-up question is, then shouldn't you at least let the union know about what you're planning on doing in case they might have a problem?
We already have. We've been in communication with
them.
Okay. Any other public comment? I don't see any.
Okay. Then I would move approval of the reclassification of the senior field services worker position as staff recommends.
All in
favor? Approval of item 11E for reclassification of senior field services as a worker position. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? 4-0. Okay. Move on to the first report.
So, two meetings of note for the month of, or since last board meeting and now, Director Bruce and I did attend Scott Valley Rotary Club on January 29th, and we gave a rousing state of the district presentation to the Rotary Club. We were upstaged, unfortunately, by a young gentleman from Spain who was on a Rotary sort of tour set of California. So that was pretty neat to hear about his interest in times in California and where he came from. Also, I attended the Connecting the Drops, which was held down on coast on February 1st. That was well attended with a good group of people and a good discussion regarding the state of the water in Santa Cruz County. It was an expert panel and an expert event, and it was well received by the community. So there was an article at the end of this board packet regarding that.
And I agree with you.
Director Boffman also did. So we will be moving along in the Barefoot States rate process. We are going to be having a public meeting at the later part of this month, February 22nd, with the Barefoot States residents again to go over past financial history of the Barefoot States system to give them a kind of a background history of where we are. Stephanie Hill is working with John Dodge Hayes to develop a presentation for them, so that we can make sure that what we're telling them is presentable and understandable. I'm looking forward to having that discussion with them so they get a better picture of their financial condition and where that system is. And had a meeting yesterday with the engineer for the probation tank replacement. That was after I wrote this statement in the board packet where I was hoping that we could go out to bid next month and have request a special board meeting in early April to award a contract. I am still hopeful that we can push that forward as fast as possible. However, I was reminded that we have PG&E asking for the power pole. Yesterday I was reminded of that raw fact, and they are not the most responsive organization in the world. So I'm hopeful that we can make connection with them and ensure that they're working with us to make that happen, because there is a poll on the way. So I will be providing updates as we move along on that project, but we are ready to go to bid. We've got the money is in place with the rate increases, we've got the permits in place, we've got the plan and specs in place. Now it's just a matter of being able to fund up and going marketing that way. So, and Fall Creek Fish Ladder. We have two projects in the Fall Creek Fish Ladder. We have the FEMA emergency repair work, and then we have the actual replacement or modification of the Fall Creek Fish Ladder. Those two projects have kind of danced around each other for the past half a year, and we've been trying to combine them, we've been separating them to best work for the district. And the current plan now is that the repair work or the modification work that is not FEMA reliant is going to be in the USDA loan package, and we're going to defer that construction for at least a year, because it has a very tight window of construction opportunity, and we need to get funding secured before we move forward on bidding that project. The plans and specs are ready, the permits are almost ready. Jen's working on those. We will expect to have those permits in hand by the time we go to bid next year. The emergency repair work, FEMA refundable repair work, we're gonna move forward on that this year. Again, it has that same type window, but it doesn't have the permit overhanging that the other one does, and the USDA loan overhang that the replacement does. And then I'm going to let Stephanie fill in on the finance and business service status report, and Rick fill in on the operations report, and then I would like to come back to the environmental report. I'll do the environmental.
I'm ready to go.
You can bring your operations whenever you want. I'll do the environmental. It's quick, and then we'll turn it over to you. I just want to point out that the Blue Ribbon panel on Sandhills Adaptive Management, they've met twice, and Ben has hopes that they'll be completed by May 2018. Possibility that will lead over into June of 2018 as well. The writing of that report is going to be a little bit more of a heavy lift than she was originally anticipating, but that's moving along. We're actually giving you the response back. Pretty happy about that. And then if you go to page 101 of the board packet, you'll see water conservation. It was earlier in the evening. Public member, I think Bob Foltz wisely made the comment that, hey, we've got to start thinking about this, and we are thinking about this. We are very well aware of the rainfall or lack of rainfall and the condition of the system, and the need for water management and conservation, and what the district needs to do in terms of all of these events coming into place. And so we are recognizing that. We're starting to make progress. If you read, I'm not going to read it all, but just if you go through the water conservation paragraphs and through the bullet points there, you'll see that we are starting to initiate drought concerns and conditions. And then the last thing I want to point out is that we are going to be hosting, or we're going to be having a State of the San Lorenzo River Symposium on March 17th. And I encourage everybody and anybody who is interested to attend. And then there's also going to be a Lessons Learned from the Bear Fire. This district is actually participating in hosting that event, and that will be on February 28th at the Bear Creek Country Club. So that will also be interesting discussions if people can attend that one.
We are moving into the 2018 mainline flushing program for the end of this month, February 27th. We'll be starting in the Ianiquil Hall areas, and we'll do Ianiquil Hall, Benelome, and Lompico, and Scottsdale and the Woods area for our flushing this year. That's to move the remove iron and manganese sediment deposits in our mainline. It's an annual program. Important to do even with drought potential, it's an important water quality operation of the district. We are moving ahead with the blue tank replacement. We now have all the reports back in, on the concrete slab, the existing concrete slab. You all remember we had no records as we inherited the Manana Wood system from Manana Woods. There was no design records of the tank or the foundation. Before we put the tank back, we wanted to be sure that the foundation was adequate to support the tank. And we've received all the written reports now and given it to engineering firms to do the analysis to tell us that we can put the tank back on that foundation. We're still moving ahead with the Felton Water System water meter replacement program, and we're continuing with the system-wide replacement program until all the meters are changed after at that. Drought and production, we are creeping up. Our percentage between now and 2013 was only about 6.6%, so we are close narrowing that gap. So it's something we'll be taking a look at. That's not saying that's all consumption, it could be leakage. That's something we'll be looking at during the budget year. System-wide leakage analysis testing. For the month of January, we were in compliance at the Fall Creek Fish Ladder. That's month by month, where we were for that month. And with the drought, most likely as we get into to April, it's high probability we will not be in compliance. With that, those are the highlights of the report. We are moving forward with the replacement of Paso 6. We did receive our Fish and Wildlife approval to move forward, and why we're obtaining commitment to that review. That was probably the last major referral. With that, if you have any questions, or any in particular,
before I go to the public to comment, I will just go to director's reports and we'll have to any comment.
Director's
communications.
I got it.
Okay. I come back. Well. Okay. I'll come back to the neighbor.
I would like to draft. I believe that a letter is in order to send to Christian Kittleson with the juvenile steelhead, group. Just following up on what we discussed at the meeting last month, and in particular with Director Bruce's recommendation to come follow up with a report on
so we're still waiting to hear back.
From them, but I believe that a letter is in order that the board just follow up and make sure that just basically a summary of what we discussed at that meeting, in particular, Director Bruce's recommendation to follow up on what she needed, you know, basically on, in addition, basically summarizing, I'll send out a draft letter to the board to if they would like to edit it and so that the letter goes out to that group. And then it's also CC to all the other water districts, basically. I think it's appropriate that
are you asking for an agenda item?
Well, I apologize. I didn't want to maybe bring this to this meeting, but it's basically, it's not something that really needs to be brought to the board meeting, but it's just basically a correspondence letter to the JSSH, following up on what was discussed with our board, what you brought up about that.
I think it might just be the course, ask Jen to follow up if there's any correspondence owing between us and Ms. Kielsen about next steps for us, particularly with regard to how, I think it was a, what was the, there's both, there's a...
The reason why I bring this up is because I can't, as a single board member, I can't, it has to be a board.
Well, Gina,
I think we're starting to discuss an item.
This started to sound like a request for action. It should be a separate board member.
So if any director wants to comment on and suggest something, then that's something they can do outside of the board meeting. Not being an agendized item tonight, the board can't.
It's just a correspondence. It's just sort of a correspondence issue that I can either bring to the future meeting on agenda item or whatever you decide on that. But I just want to bring that out to the board's attention that I believe that our correspondence to the JSSH to express our opinion or what we discussed or what we decided to follow up on that.
I encourage you to speak with staff about it and see if there's a way that could be in
I will do that.
For either agendizing or having whatever.
I will send a draft recommendation to staff to follow up on that without any other discussion.
I kind of skipped committee reports, program director's communications. I'll go back. Anybody else? Yeah. Other communications?
So one of the things that I note with pleasure from Jen's report, the environmental report, is the AmeriCorps team that has been led by Linda Skemp of the Valley Women's Club working on invasive plant removal. AmeriCorps teams work all over the state in many, many different communities on many different things. And the current federal budget proposal has suggested eliminating all AmeriCorps funding and all senior corps funding in future years. And for those of you who know the value to communities of AmeriCorps service, I would suggest that if you find these kinds of programs of value that you contact your appropriate representative and voice an opinion.
I'll just mention that the Groundwater Sustainability Agency will meet on February 28th of this month. I'll report back something from them after that. Part of that is will also be a technical committee that would be meeting to consider statements of qualification regarding updating the groundwater model and also in facilitation services for the JPJ. That also conflicts with the Bear Creek lessons learned meeting, so pick one, if you choose to do. And that's it for me. Pardon? Oh, the grant. Oh, that was, I believe that was mentioned in the environmental report, was the one that got the grant from DWR?
We did have a news article at the very tail end of the package. That was the first thing I thought about the grant. So the JPA did receive $1 million grant to help fund the groundwater sustainability plan. That is about half of what it's going to take to do that. So that is about probably $400,000 that this district doesn't have to contribute to the JPA.
That's great. Okay. So, committee reports. I'd ask for one future committee agenda item. Anybody else? Anybody like a thing for us? They don't feel long? So, I don't.
And you can even report to give.
Okay.
Or you, sure, the admin committee met recently. Date, forgetting the date at the moment. We spoke about, we had three issues, although one of them we didn't get to very much. Staff brought to us a preview of the Casa Tiempo well design, the good contract. That had some brief discussion. We had general discussion of communications and outreach goals and objectives for the district, and staff is committing to bring a request for proposal, a draft RFP for communication support for the committee's consideration. It's probably going to take a few cycles through the committee, probably not too many, because we'd like to get moving on this, but it'll have committee input. But that first draft will be coming to us in March. We spoke a little bit about advocacy priorities for the water district upcoming either legislative or regulatory issues. This is very early in the legislative season. There are going to be some really interesting things on the ballot in terms of initiatives, and there's going to be some really interesting legislation as well around water, the water energy nexus and energy that's likely to either benefit or impact the district that we'll be keeping an eye on as the legislative season rolls along. That's pretty much it.
And we had a brief discussion on public goods charge on that, and we moved on to the agenda item for legislative, the current legislative violence. I'll basically just very quick note on budget and finance committee that we went back and looked at probably for the last time in 2016-17 actual district budget and discussed the community board plan at that meeting. And that's all I think I have to say.
Did I see anything about the environmental committee since I was asking for that meeting? I killed that brain cell. Well, they've been covered by the environmental reports pretty much. It was the Blue Ribbon Committee and some of the other fish level.
If there's nothing else from the board, I'll ask openness if the public would like to comment on any of the reports that have been presented. I'll hand one up first.
It's not a really waste. I'm just curious, how many gallons does it take to flush the system when we do that?
Millions.
And relative to, I guess, how many gallons do we sell in a month, and how many gallons does it take to flush the system? I'm kind of curious about that.
I believe it's over twice the volume of whatever section of the water main that you're flushing, but it depends if you're trying to flush out this water. That iron and manganese crap that gets into the water.
I understand the essential part of why to do it. I'm just curious how many gallons.
I'll get to it.
Well, first off, we're not flushing the entire system, just parts of it, and we'll be able to give you a gallon when we're done. We actually calculate each day of flushing it varies. It'll probably be close to a couple hundred thousand gallons, maybe a maximum of 500,000 gallons. But as long as we do it every year, it's less and less. But at the end of flushing season, about 6 weeks, we'll be able to do the calculation.
And for a monthly spectrum, for example, there's about 43,000 units consumed in December. That's about 32 million gallons.
Or about an acre foot out of something over 1,000 acre feet or something. So a tenth of a percent or something of the water goes to flushing. I don't know. Okay, I believe Ms. Lowman had her hand.
Yeah, I also have a question for Rick. It's about the installing meters in the Dalton system. It's about 1,200 customers, I think. And in Montego, there were 500. And once you have the texting meter automatic, you can set up an account with a company that's called Ion Water and review what you use every day. We offered to be a test for this, and I don't believe it's been widespread yet. And that was my question. Is for us, we were able to catch a whole lot of leaks that you wouldn't have been able to see. This would save the district. I have enormous amounts of water, and everybody was able to have this capability. And I'm wondering, when is that going to go online for everybody?
We're working with the customer service people, and they're getting up to speed on software to be able to talk to people at the farm.
Yeah, but what you see, what you're able to see for the leak detection, we're able to see as well for all the meters that are active. So there are people checking for those daily, detecting any of those high grade or low grade.
In our case, it was knowing our regular use, which you wouldn't know, and knowing which day we were away, and knowing we didn't use water on certain days, the same water use. So
it's very cool, and we're getting ready, the staff's getting trained with all the different instructions, because it is something that you do want to make sure that when you're getting people logging in for the first time that they're not having a bad experience, because you want them to be able to utilize it. There's, I believe, approximately 500 meters going into the Felton area. Once that phase is complete, then we'll do a big push, because we'll have a little bit of a break between new meters. I kind of wanted to wait until that was done. That way we didn't have a bunch of people attempting, not knowing, because sometimes people don't even know that they're on the new meter.
We do get a daily readout. We get a little more information than you get on the Ion Water. We get a daily readout of potential leaks that it counts for us by looking at past usage and usage in 24-hour period. And that's when the office staff looks at those and gets the word out to those people or double checks those and see what they have to be. So we're doing some leakage reporting back to people.
Okay. This summer-ish is what I'm anticipating for a rollout. It's a cool tool.
Yes. Well, I want to say something about the flushing. You know, Longica wasn't flushed for eons. And we finally got, I can remember we finally got one area flushed where it's a dead end. You cannot believe what the water looked like. I think I showed you the picture of the bathtub with the yellow duck, and the water was the same color as the duck. Flushing is imperative. It needs to be done if we're going to have good water. So I was so pleased that you're doing flushing. The other thing, it's great you got this $1 million grant for the groundwater sustainability thing. It's terrific. I used to go to those meetings in Scotts Valley for the Santa Margarita Basin. People ought to go. It's fascinating. It's very informative. So anyway, and thank you for what you do.
Bruce got his hand up.
I just wanted to point out on the
Can I point out that the right over here is where the microphone is, and I'm not catching what everybody's saying unless they come. You're particularly far away. This is my microphone.
I couldn't tell if you're pointing over here or over there.
No, right here at the podium. Thank you.
That's not a podium.
Electric.
there were some stories in there, in a couple of papers a couple of weeks ago, that said that the district paid for Terry Vieira's legal defense for a time. But there's an $11,000 check on the bill list to Terry Vieira's lawyer for the month of December. Also, there's another check from a law firm called Rutman Tucker. To the best of my knowledge, the only thing Rutman Tucker ever does for this district is the Charlene Hebert case, Hebert 1. I guess there's Hebert 2 now. Hebert 1 has ground to a conclusion, as I understand it. Then President Ratcliffe told us in August that the Hebert case had been settled. Brian Lee told us that he'd struck a bargain on July 31st. So it's been more than 6 months, and there's still no payment to Rutman Tucker. So I'm hoping it's done. It's right around $200,000 spent on the Hebert case. Hebert 1. In January, there was a payment to Rutman Tucker for more than $5,000. In December, there was a payment for exactly $5,000 that went to Charlene's attorney. So that was the district's settlement of Hebert 1, was a $5,000 check written in December. And it's unbelievable that the law firm, the town, even in January, they're still charging more than $5,000 per month. And anyway, I hope they're done. But now that the Hebert 1 case is done, I think it'd be a good time to do a post-mortem on that case. Waive all your privileges. Just go ahead and tell us what the case was all about. What was it really about? Why did you spend $200,000 defending a case that ultimately was settled for $40,000? And the district only paid the $5,000 deductible. So the other $35,000, I guess, came from insurance. So why would you spend $200,000 over a five-year period when the whole thing got settled for $5,000 worth of district money? I mean, there's a level of obstinacy there, just a level of pure obstinacy to the point of obduracy. Wake up. There's, you know, that's not a business-like approach. Business people wouldn't do that. Business people would have cleaned up that case a long time ago. So I think it's time for a postmortem. I think it failed. Maybe it failed because of Mark Thomas. And he's gone now, so that's great. And maybe we'll have fewer of these failures in the future. But boy, what a heck of a lot of money. And you know, when we raised the budget for legal services, if you can tell President Kaufman, he said you had to. You had to. So you think you had to spend $200K for legal one? Explain it.
John Souls from Felton. I was kind of wondering when you talk about Fall Creek and we have this drought, and I'm wondering, I haven't heard anything lately about the Bull Creek input, Mr. Felton, or the idea of trying to find a way to get some of the water from Loch Lomond. And so I was just wondering if there are any reports on that, or maybe the next meeting, any kind of updates or information on those items would be greatly appreciated.
Any engineering or do you want? Okay.
Thank you.
Sure. Anybody else?
Lou Ferris Felton. I'd like to follow up on a question that Bob had about the flushing, and that is, you answered the question how much, but you didn't answer, or what we didn't talk about yet, is what happens to the water that you flush. My fear is it goes down the drain. And if I am right, is there any way of taking that water and reusing it, even as recycled water? I mean, going into a drought, we need to do everything we can to save and use the water that we have. I understand the need to flush. In fact, it's a regulatory requirement, I believe, right? The state requires that we do flushing at least once every 3 years. But irregardless, that's a lot of water. That's a lot of water that, if I'm right, is going down the drain. And is there anything we can do to reuse, repurpose that water?
Dr. Baker.
we try to use, when we do flush, we try to do it surface water. So that's water that's already going down. It's not coming out of the aquifers, it's coming out of the stream sources. We do our best management practices to dechlorinate, make sure we follow fish and game requirements and state requirements to discharge back into the stream flows. So it's kind of taking it out of one stream and putting it back into another, so to speak. But that's not quite as bad as pulling out of aquifers. Once you start flushing, it's a continuous process. You don't start and stop, otherwise any type of sediment that you break loose in the main and start to flush out will travel throughout the mainland. You don't get it out through the fire line. So you have to have a continuous line of trucks, basically, to haul it somewhere. And then, you know, where are you going to haul it? You have to discharge it. It gets very cumbersome and very expensive for the amount of water. Unfortunately, this time of year, we'll probably be using about 50% of well water. And usually, it's all surface water. It's not quite the pads or pumps, so to speak. You just discharge it back. But you would have to have a lot of trucks. You know, it would be quite an engineering thing to do it. You can do it, but and then they have certain equipment that you can take the water, treat it, push it back into the mainland. But our system is not curb and gutter, not loop. Very difficult to do. I do believe Soquel Creek has one of those treatment trailers that they take out and you hook to one fire hydrant. You treat the water as it goes through and flushes, and it goes back into another fire hydrant. Very difficult to do on our system because we don't have typical we have loop systems where you can push the water through. But the key is to try to use as much surface water as possible. And if we do it every year, it's less water than dry. When we did Wapito, it took a lot of water because it hasn't been done so long. But now this year, we bet it's 50% more water. And most of that last year, we had such an abundance of surface water, it was all surface water last year. Very little water. So that's the key to try to use as much surface water as possible.
But are we sure that we've exhausted every option? I mean, could we? I mean, I understand the cost associated with moving water that's being flushed, but what about percolation ponds? Or any way to try to get the water?
You gotta get it there. You gotta get it there. In our valley, you know, look at the valley. It's not set up to where we have fields we can discharge to. Our drainage goes right into streams. The valley is difficult to flush and not have the water almost immediately go into the drainage channel and back into one of the streams. Because all the major, you know, roadways are right along the streams. Diamond Creek, Boulder Creek, you know, San Lorenzo. It's difficult.
I understand it'd be difficult, but going into a potential drought, I mean, if we could be a year from now wishing we had done something with that water, and I'm just trying to be a little proactive.
I
know it's hard.
I understand.
But.
Well, thank you, Rick.
No, I answered your question, but that's what we do.
Okay. Very well. Any other public comment on the report? I don't see any. That gets us to written communication and informational material, which is in the packet. We've referred quite to it. Some interesting things in